In this video, I'm going to be fixing up this Countax C38H from 2005, fitted with a single cylinder Honda GXV390 engine. So it's all not too bad. Bit of flaking paint. I'll probably get that re-powder coated. You can see the gearbox in there. Quite a bit of aluminium oxide, so I'm going to have to take that off, clean it up, and we'll also change the oil, something which isn't usually done, but it should be. Now this is actually the high grass mulch deck, which is not as common. It's not for formal lawns, it's for slashing down long brush. The blades seem fairly new, in good condition. Should be like a bar, a little rod that runs through here, which you hang the chains off. Oh, and the bearings. I was looking at the price of a new deck shell, and it's like £600, so not really worth it. But I came across this one over here. And you're probably thinking, well, that's even worse. And it does look worse, but it actually isn't. The difference is it is solid. So what I'm going to do is strip it down and then get it all sandblasted and powder coated. Might be a few little marks left, a few pits left in the surface of it. But it will be far better than the one over here, which really is completely rotten. Thank you. I've just removed the blades from the rotten deck, which is this one here, and I've laid them next to the set of blades from the one we're going to restore. And it's quite an interesting discovery, really. The picking and packing sticker is still present on one of them, and you can see that it was actually, well, picked or dispatched or something on the 10th of May 2018. So those blades are quite new. I think they only changed the main set, they didn't change the sort of wing blades, which assist with the mulching. But yeah, I didn't think they looked too old, they do look quite good. So I'm going to put the blades from the rotten deck on the restored mower, we'll give them a good sharpen. Just have a quick listen to the bearings. Yeah, I'm going to change them all. Belt's worn through the idler, must have jammed. That one's not too bad, but could probably do with a replacement. I'm going to have to get these priced up. There's the frame, the rod, and the chains are okay, but they should probably be replaced. Thank you. I've just sent the deck off to be sandblasted and powder coated, so that should be back in a few weeks' time. In the meantime, I can now continue to change the bearings in these spindles. And to do this, I'm going to be using this 10-ton Clark bench press, which was very kindly donated to the channel by Machine Mart earlier in the year. Thank you. Now all three hubs have been cleaned up and repainted for anti-protection, I'm just going to very quickly run through all the different parts required to rebuild these, and then I'm going to rebuild one of them just so you can see exactly how it's done. So first of all, two new bearings for each one, 6205RS, that's a sealed bearing. There's also a seal that goes in the bottom of the hub to keep dirt out. The plastic washer, again, I believe it is just to assist with keeping it clean, because obviously dirt in the bearings will soon wear them out, premature wear. And finally, a new end cap. Now, you can use the old end cap, but I don't like to. The reason why is because they get very rusty. They also get very slightly dented, and basically what happens is if they do get a slight dent in them, they start to wear away at the hub. You have to replace the whole thing. So for the very low cost that these are, they're like £3 each, it is worth replacing them. You can sand them round so that it's not digging in anymore, so it's not eating in. But the problem with that is it then doesn't leave a tight fit. And the idea is to also keep the dirt out. So you want to keep a nice tight fit, because you want to do everything you can to keep grit and unwanted debris out of the hubs. So that's what is required to rebuild these. All three are exactly the same, so I'm just going to do the one, and then you get a good idea of what's going to be happening. You can see that I've also cleaned it internally. This is where the bearing will sit, and this is where the seal will sit. So it needs to be free of dirt and grease. Otherwise, it's just going to cause problems in the future. At this stage, I'd just like to check it over, make sure I've done everything correctly. There's only really two things that you can do wrong in this process. Firstly, you could forget to put the spacer in, the middle spacer, before you put the second bearing in. Secondly, you could push this seal in too far. What that would do is it would bind up with the bearing wouldn't turn. So you've just got to get it in there, sort of flush, but not so far that you get it stuck on the bearing. So that is now ready to put the spindle in. Now for the finishing touches. There we go, finished. So just need to do two more of those and then I'll be ready to fit them to the deck. Okay, so the deck is now back. It's been sandblasted and powder coated and it's looking much better than it was before. Although it does show up the pitting, this was expected. If you look at it in this sort of lighting, it makes it look quite bad. But the thing is, it's solid. It's been protected. It's got a good primer as well. Really good undercoat. And yeah, it's going to be a good deck. I've also just received my parts order as well. I've got the new belt, that's the internal belt, AA105. There is the new rear rubber flap and the fixing strip for it. It's good to see that they have actually upgraded this. It's about twice the width it used to be. So yeah, that's good. And then we have the chain holders. These go at the front under here. They had rotted through on the original. And also some hardware. Various bits of hardware. Let's get it rebuilt. That's cleaned them up quite well. I think I will just give them a quick sharpen, but they're really not too bad. They're quite new. The wing blades are slightly more worn, but still not too bad. There's not a huge amount to say about blade sharpening. All you're really looking for is a uniform edge. You don't want to have multiple edges, so the same angle throughout. And also, I prefer to use a bench grinder on a fine grinding disc, since it doesn't heat the metal up, it keeps it quite cool. Whereas a hand grinder or a very coarse disc is going to remove a lot of material very fast, and it does create quite a bit of heat. You also have to keep it balanced. These do work, but I personally prefer to use the magnetic blade balancers. You can also just put a nail or a screw into a piece of level wood. But that is fine. Here's a closer view just showing you that it's just one angle. One more tip. You got to make sure everything is as clean as possible, because the grass buildup and debris is enough to knock it out of balance. So it's going to give you a false reading. So you want to make sure that as much as of this dirt is removed as possible first. It probably won't make a huge difference to this type of balancer, but certainly to the magnetic wall balancer. They are very sensitive. There's no real benefit of painting the blades except for making them look better. These are the parts required to refit the blades. Firstly, some high tensile M8 bolts. They're for the two sides. High tensile M10 for the centre. Some locking tabs that prevents the bolts from removing themselves. Lock washers for the bolts. These washers go underneath the locking tab. And of course the square spacer which goes in between the two blades. Bolts tight. Just need to fold the tab over. That will prevent these bolts from loosening. So right over onto the head. I really don't know how well known Countax and Westwood are in places like the USA, but if you have heard of them, please do let me know. I think they are quite a well known brand throughout Europe as well as the UK, certainly Eastern Europe. The next thing I'm going to do, because the deck is upside down, is fit the chains and the rod, which goes on the back and the front. You might remember these. The old ones aren't great. They would work, but I think it's probably about time they were replaced. Now, instead of just buying hundreds of the genuine chain pieces, I've just bought a whole length of chain just here. And the reason why is, well, it's cheaper, and also I think, I don't know, but as a guess, whenever I've bought parts before, everything comes individually wrapped in plastic, and if I had, say, 120 of these, if they were individually wrapped, I'm not saying they are, but if they were, that would be quite a bit of plastic used. I'd prefer just to lose a link every time I cut four, and then that metal will be recycled anyway. That should be enough. What a difference. Yeah, I'm so pleased I've changed these. Now, you could have put them in some kind of rust converter and then painted them, but it's not the same as them being coated as they are. These ones are galvanized. At the end of all this, that's what was cut off. So not too bad. I'm still left with loads of chain, and that's going to be recycled. Time to start threading chain. Very simple job. I think, yeah, this must have been the first hole because otherwise they won't fit in. Very satisfying though, especially when it's done. Yeah, that looks good. So they'll dampen the blow of any debris flying out. Next are the front chains, and this is all very similar except we have to actually fit the holders as well. There's four holds in total, in pairs, there's two different sizes. You can see the length difference in the bar which I've just cut, the round bar. It's supposed to be 7mm, that is actually 8, but it's fine because it's just going on the link width. As long as the bar goes through the chain, there won't be an issue, so it's actually upgraded it. We've also got the bolts, the washers, and the flange nuts. Right, this has been a tricky one to sort out. I've just been attempting to get the chains through many times, and I think this is the only way of doing it. You put the first thing through completely, instead of just trying to slot it through halfway, and then I'm hoping I can put the rod through all of them, and then pull that second link back out. Should all make sense in a minute. It's the only way that I can see this is going to work. Okay, so the rod is through, but now I sort of have to twist the entire chain round, all of them, to get that second link to go back down. This is tricky. Yeah, certainly proving more difficult than I thought it would be. That first link might be going. Yep, that first link's gone. Okay, there we go. The first two chains have done it. They've gone through. There's the third one. What I don't want is for one to fall out, because that means starting all over again. There's the first one. The others should be simple now that I've figured out how to do it. As I mentioned, there are two different sizes. The shorter ones go on the inside, and the longer ones in the middle. Moving on to the top side of the deck, I'm going to first of all put some copper grease onto the shafts, basically anti-seize. Next are the jockey pulleys, or idler pulleys, whatever you want to call them, on this fairly rusty plate. I'm just going to clean things up a bit and of course replace the pulleys. They are completely worn out. The bracket looks better, and these are the new jockey pulleys on here. I decided to replace both of them. This spring will go around this hole here. I don't know how well you could hear that, but the clutch bearing is quite noisy, so that is going to have to be changed. Unfortunately, you can't really change just the bearing, you have to change the whole clutch. Before I do anything with the clutch though, we're going to take a look at the transmission. The ones fitted to these are the Tough Torque K46E gearboxes, they're hydrostatic, and they're pretty good when they work, but they can get weak over time. The best way of preventing it is to keep the oil change, which not many people do. So I think the reason why is because it is quite a long-winded process. You have to take the gearbox off to do it properly. But that's what we're going to do, because it's all very oxidized on the outside. I want to clean it up anyway, so as it's off, we might as well just change the oil. So we have a few things to disconnect. We've got a nut here, that's for the drive, it's forward and backwards. We have the belt. There's also a belt guide in front of the gearbox, and also the brake linkage.
Well, there it is. All seems good. Sometimes there can be play in the pulley. The fan can have fins missing. This is where the reservoir would go. So when we drain it, I need to make sure that nothing gets into there. But yeah, it's just going to be a case of cleaning it up. And then I think I'll probably powder coat the red deflector there and make it look much nicer. But otherwise, yeah, it's just a case of cleaning it up, changing the oil, and putting it back on the machine. Now let's remove some of the oxidation. Obviously it's not perfect. You can't really get it perfect unless you were to sandblast it or paint it. Now this seal is actually quite perished. And usually whenever you remove these, it is best to replace them anyway, because I've had them leak, even if they look good. And then we have the magnets in here, designed to pick up any metallic debris. It's not too bad actually. This is a good gearbox. Before I put the magnet back in, I'm going to put the oil in, because that way I can get the funnel down. The next step is to put the new cap on, put the fan back on and the pulley, then I can sort out the reservoir just here. So there we go, that is now ready to fit back onto the mower. However, because I'm going to replace the rear back panel, as I have a better one, it would actually be easier to refit the gearbox when the original one is off. This rear panel is actually bubbling up, blistering, a bit of flaking paint, and the handbrake as well is actually not looking too good. But as I have one, I might as well just swap it over, and it will also make it easier to refit the reservoir, the tank which goes in here. The only thing left to do is to bleed the gearbox, and then I can focus on the rear deflector, which I'm going to powder coat, and then after that we can move on to the front of the machine, servicing the engine, changing the clutch, all that sort of stuff.
Next, I'm going to replace the clutch. with this good used one just here. They're quite expensive, but that one is really quiet, so that's going to be as good as new. This one, however, is just extremely loud. It works, but it's just noisy. Well, these pulleys don't seem too bad. I think they'll be okay. We'll keep them. Just in here, the clutch is held in place by a retaining bracket that prevents it from spinning all the way around. If you forget to put that in, the clutch will just spin around, it'll rip all the wires out. So that's the one that came off. The pulley block is stuck, which is really common. I do have another one, which I just put a bit of copper grease on. And I put that one into the new clutch, the good used clutch. You can tell the difference. Next is the new drive belt. The guides have their own slots to go in, so you can't really get this wrong. I've just loosened both of these off. I put the belt on the clutch assembly first, then around the front, and finally around the back. And there we go, a nice new tensioned belt. The next thing to do is to give it a quick service. I've got the genuine service kit, 10W30 oil, with the spark plug, fuel filter, and the air filter. What I need to do is start the engine up, circulate the oil a bit, just to make it a bit thinner, and to mix up any sludge so that it would be drained out through the drain port. You can hear how much quieter the clutch is. It's actually got a bit of water in it. I think the previous owner of this did keep it outside. I'll leave that draining as I do the air filter and the fuel filter. That is the new air filter. Just going to remove the old one. And I will oil the new one. It doesn't look too bad. But yeah, it does need to be replaced. I've seen much worse. This engine doesn't have an oil filter. Okay, so that is dead on the top mark. And just down there is the fuel filter. I'll just remove this side panel. What I'll do is I'll clamp the fuel line just here. That prevents it from leaking. There will of course be some fuel in the fuel line. Don't know how well you can see that on camera, but that is absolutely full of debris, dirt, and congealed something. Fuel, I guess. I'm going to trim a bit off the end of here where it's expanded. And this fuel line is actually a different inside internal diameter to this one here. So it'll only fit one way. There we go. There's not really any space for me to film changing the spark plug, but you get the idea. I'm gonna take the old one out, put this one in. Simple stuff. That is the service done to the engine, and the whole machine is looking much better now. But there is one thing which I have been trying to ignore, but I just can't, because I always want the machine to look as good as possible, and it's the front axle. You're just drawn to it. All the paint is flaking off it. So my plan, although it is going to take quite a bit of work, is to strip down the front end, remove the axle, and then powder coat it. The whole front section is mounted in front of it. So the bonnet, the muffler, all of the deck hangers and the bonnet brackets. And then of course there's things like the track rods and the steering arm all attached to it as well. So it is possible, I've done it before, but it did take a bit of time. But I think on this occasion it is going to pay off, since that is the only thing which looks really bad. And you are drawn to it, you look at the whole machine, yeah, there's a bit of flaking on the chassis here. Obviously I can't repaint the chassis, that would be just a huge job, stripping down the entire machine. But the axle, it just stands out as being bad. Wheel number one is stuck. And wheel number two is stuck as well. Good. Right, so that one's going to move. At least one moves. Just the other one, which is totally stuck. as suspected. Very bad. But I think it's straight. I don't think it's bent. These bearings will need to be replaced. And yeah, I managed to get the stub axles out of there. They weren't actually that stuck. One of them was much worse than the other. But I thought they were worse than what they actually were. As for the exhaust, or the muffler, yeah, one of the bolts did shear off. Although it was a bit different to usual. Usually they actually snap and it just broke at the weld. So that can either be tack welded back on or maybe even JB welded. But yeah, I'm sure it's going to be reusable. There'll always be a few pieces inside which you can't get out, but I think that is going to be good enough. And these marks that you see, the beauty of the disc which I was using is it's a paint removal disc and it doesn't really scar the metalwork like a flappy grinding disc would do. So although, yeah, it looks like it's all marked, it isn't deep at all, very shallow. So when this is powder coated, you shouldn't see any of that. Should be a nice uniform application and it should look almost as good as new. The only other thing I need to do before I can powder coat is to punch these bearings out. They're going to be replaced. They are not good actually. They do need to come out for powder coating, but I can barely turn it. Grinding away. Oh, and before I forget, yeah, there is a dent in the top of the axle on this side. But that is fine, it doesn't affect it in any way. The axle is straight, so it's just a bit of a aesthetic thing, really. The two bearings on this stub axle, going through the axle beam, are even worse. There's one, that's what's left of it. Just completely got destroyed. And here's the other one.
And there we have it, a freshly powder coated front axle. The last thing to do is to fit the bearings. As you can see, I've cleaned up inside here. And there we go, almost as good as new except for the little dent which is at this end. 6203, 3/4. Slightly more unusual than normal actually, those bearings, which does make them a bit more expensive. But the wheels take the same ones. Well, there we go, that's back together. Did take a bit of work, but with the new tyres and the painted axle, it does look much better. I've also fitted the painted rear deflector. But it's almost there, just got to do a few finishing touches like cleaning behind this lens, which does come off, always fills with dirt. And I need to refit the deck, and then we'll try it out. See what a good finish it's left. It's really mulched it up.